You've laughed before, no doubt you'll laugh again. But in this, the picture that's made to be laughed at, you'll find more comedy crammed into 1 mile of celluloid than ever before in the history of the entertainment world. Can I prove it? Look!
I'm a dragon.
One should never compare a pedigreed thoroughbred with a creature of dubious ancestry.
A bit of a mongrel, is it?
Keep those surgical instruments as sterile as an ABC gardening program.
You must remember this. A kiss is just a kiss. A sigh is just a sigh. Fundamental things apply as time goes by. It's still the same old story, a fight for love and glory.
The whole thing is a great big joke. You know, you're drowning in floods one minute, you're being cooked in a bushfire the next. What else can any Australian do except laugh?
And you get sort of lines about, funny lines about, you know, the harvest was so crooked that the sparrows had to get down on their hands and knees to get at the wheat, that sort of thing, you know. Or the drover's blankets were so thin that you could drag them all the way from Boolia to Birdsville and they still wouldn't pick up a bird.
It is true that much of the traditional Australian humour comes from the bush. The Hayseeds and Steel Rudd's Dad and Dave are our best-known comic characters. And in no less than 16 different movies about their exploits, we've laughed at situations as simple as a possum lobbing into bed.
We have a very rich vein of deeply sardonic humour in Australia. The custodians of it are largely taxi drivers. And homosexuals and homosexual taxi drivers and black and white cartoonists.
What Barry Humphries says is also true, and it was a black and white artist, Stan Cross, who gave us the most famous cartoon in our history.
For God's sake, stop laughing! This is serious!
But really, in the long run, humour comes from no place in particular. A laugh is anywhere you find it.
Even when it's slightly crude, it's very delicate and gentle. For instance, if a horse starts off fast from the barrier, a race commentator is likely to say he's off like a bride's nighty, which has got a certain sort of innuendo in it, but nonetheless you get a sense of speed.
And there's the very famous one of the sign, which apparently really happened out at Hawthorne, where the Hawthorne church had, "What would you do if Christ came to Hawthorne?" And the fellow wrote underneath, "Shift Peter Hudson to centre half forward."
He was born in Adelaide in 1892, the fourth child of an immigrant Dutch bookmaker. His name was Harry van der Sluis, and his parents hoped that, like a good Jewish boy, he'd grow up healthy and settle down to a nice, respectable job. Boy Roy, Roy Reen, Mo McCacky. By whatever name, he was perhaps the funniest and most original stand-up comedian Australia ever produced.
Except that you can beat it. You get me? Beat it!
I don't have to be told twice. There's only two words for you.
What are they?
Goodbye.
Dame Sybil Thorndike called him the greatest living clown. Jack Benny watched him again and again to try and learn the secret of his timing. He was everybody's favourite mug lair, lewd, spluttering, the eternal prankster and lurk merchant, none of which amused his family.
Put those down! What's the matter? Put those down!
Hey! Hey, quick!
Oh, go down!
They never wanted him to be in show business at all, but he'd made up his mind right in the beginning he was going to be in show business.
Mm.
And they were in racing line, they were bookmakers, and they always wanted him to carry on, because the father before them was a bookmaker. Mm. He said, no, not in your life. And he'd go out and appear in all the different suburbs in Melbourne, and for a matter of a few shillings a night then, and he'd say in the breakfast, they'd send people out to boo him and give him the bird, as we call it.
His own family?
His own family, yes. Because they wanted to break his heart. They wanted to get him out of show business.
But Moe was unstoppable. By 1914, he'd perfected the Roy Rean character and grotesque black and white makeup that was to become his trademark. With Nat Phillips as Stiffy, the two were the most successful comedy act on the Australian stage. The Stiffy and Moe partnership lasted 18 years, and by that time, Harry van der Sluis was the biggest thing in the business. Moe made just this one film, Strike Me Lucky. It's the only extended visual record of the artist at work.
If you tell me where the gold is hidden, I'll let you go. Listen, you can put me on the spot today. You can put me on the spot tomorrow. You can put me on the spot till I haven't any spots left. But remember, a woman never tells.
Hang up, hang up.
I'll go this joke in a second. I'll go him. Gallimore.
He was insanely jealous of anybody else that did well in the show. And when Larry Adler was out here, Adler was one of the greatest harmonica players in the world, and he was doing very well. And somebody said to him, that Larry Adler's a great performer, isn't he, William? Well, he said, I can't see it. Take away his mouth organ, he wouldn't be worth a zack.
As in most of Moe's stage routines, the plot of Strike Me Lucky gets hopelessly lost amongst the gags. It's really just a pile of zany situations, strung together by Moe's bizarre and often quite suggestive style.
What a salesman! Tell me, were you ever into business?
To travel.
What in?
Well, to tell you the truth, I was a lady's underwear.
And how was the business?
Too scared to... I'm sorry, sir.
No! Look! But I'm sure. Say, who are you?
I'm Robertson Crusoe, and that's my goat.
I know who it is.
Who?
Cat Whittaker and his dick. No, Dick Whittaker and his cat.
Most of his gags and sketches, they had a double meaning. And he could convey to the audience with a lift of an eyebrow. But he sighed. It was up to them if they took it that way. And there were two sides.
And when you worked together, did you ever feel he was going just that little bit too far?
Yes, and I would just shake my head from side to side and he'd stop.
From the 1940s, Moe was troubled by periodic bouts of ill health. An unbroken stage career of 30 years was beginning to take its toll. But against all advice, he decided to take on even more work, this time on radio. The legendary Macaque Mansion show was born. And Moe conquered a whole new generation who'd never seen him during the great old days of vaudeville. Even in rehearsal, the Roy Rean touch came through loud and clear.
Stomach aching out, come on.
Hey, Dad. Dad, there's a young lady at the door.
A young lady? The little Trimmer. Pronounce her, Harry. Go on, open the door and pronounce her.
Miss Olivia Shakespeare.
No, don't move. Just stand there. Oh, but how wonderful. Just like the three witches from Macbeth.
Strike me lucky, did you hear that? She said I had clean breeches and bad breath.
Offstage, he was a very lonely man. He had no social graces at all. He hated going to parties or things like that. In his own home, he was a very good host. He loved his family. One of my favourite stories about him was that he never liked eating in restaurants because he used to say the food isn't cooked with love. And he meant that anything that Sadie made for him was very better than he could buy in a restaurant.
We used to come home from the Tivoli at night, and we used to come round the corner into Cottenham Avenue in Kensington. And when we turned that corner, he never failed to say, Happy Road.
Happy Road.
Happy Road. And he meant that. That meant more to him, that little house that we had there, than anything.
Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of myself and my
Mo was a man of modest ambitions, but his legacy is enormous. By the time he died in 1954, his unique style had already influenced the course of Australian humour for the rest of the century. No less a personage than the Governor of New South Wales, Lord Beecham, wrote to Mo saying, "Your art is an important expression of the Australian ethos." With typical cheek, Mo cracked back, "Gaw blimey, I hope that's a compliment."
Feeling all right, lovely.
The fat bloke with the hat half on and more than a few grog under his belt is George Wallace. And for my money, this is still one of the funniest routines ever captured on film in Australia.
Come on, now, send me, right.
Pushed me.
Nobody pushed.
Somebody deliberately sneaked up and pushed me.
You slick. How do you know you were pushed?
How do I know I was pushed? Wasn't I there when the push happened?
Oh, go and do your dance.
Jumping out of the leg. That's the end of it. Now, I saw you that time. Now, I saw you.
Why, I never moved from this spot.
Listen, I've had 78 fights and 78 losers, but me luck's liable to change at any minute. How do you do?
Around the theatrical traps, they used to call him Sophie the Sort, the Drongo from the Congo, Fanny Shovelbottom's friend, or just plain Onkus. But to the public, he was Georgie Wallace, Australia's best-loved comedian.
He had a great big heavy voice like that, didn't he, George? A kind of husky voice, because originally he was a cane cutter. That's what made him, he was a paradox, because to look at him was a great big thick-set fellow with great big grubby-looking hands. You know, they weren't grubby, they looked the type of grubby-looking hands. You know what I mean? Big hands, and you wouldn't think he had any artistry in him at all. But looking at him, he was a contradiction.
And now, children, Uncle George is going to do a little dance for you. A story dance entitled The Dance of the Wounded Wombat. Now, you remember when that great Russian dancer was out here recently, the lady, Pavlova. No, Pavlova.
Well, Wallace made five successful films, and in all of them he played basically the same character, a bumbling, good-hearted simpleton who struggled through to the final curtain somehow. But he had his pride.
Good out. And the same to you with knobs on, beveled edges, and in 37 different positions. I remain yours truly, the Water and Sewerage Board. Go and have a bath.
On first meeting, the Wallace style and personality must have come as a shock to anyone, let alone to a genteel English vaudeville star, fresh off the boat from London.
And in walks Wallace. Well, I can honestly say I had never seen such an apparition. I think it had been out the night before, and having never seen anyone keep their pants up under a big fat stomach without braces rather fascinated me, and they stayed up all that morning, much to my amazement. Also, he had a tie spotted with tomato juice, orange, he had stains and all kinds of things down his suit, and then he started the conversation. He said, "I'm Wallace," in a very hoarse, croaky voice. I said, "Oh, how do you do?" And he said, "I'm an actual lair." So I thought that must be an aborigine of some kind. I've never heard the expression a natural lair. We don't have such a thing in England as the word lair.
When he wasn't ad-libbing, Wallace wrote most of his own material. And in amongst the laughter, he was making his own subtle observations about working-class life. His stage character was the classic Aussie battler, cunning enough to keep just on side with authority, but ready to slip in a few sly digs if he got half the chance.
What's your name?
Wallace.
Wallace.
What initials?
S.
Samuel?
Tom.
S for Tom?
Yeah. How do you get S for Tom?
I don't know, I just don't care, that's what it is.
Well, it's T, Thomas.
T.
How old are you?
11.
What?
33. I'll never forget one day.
Shut up.
Behind the child was a man who could sing, dance, paint, sculpt, play five musical instruments, and of course drink like a fish.
Listen, what's the best way to commit suicide?
Poison.
Poison?
That's the way the best people are going off this season. Poison.
With Wallace, had barely touched the sides, and there was nobody who could do a drunk scene quite like the Drongo.
Well, come on. Come, we'll go and poison ourselves.
Can you see what I can see?
It's an emu. What are you talking about? It's an ostrich.
Yeah. I see it.
It's a wallaby.
What were your sort of favourite things that you really admired about him?
Oh, I think it's when he used to get lost. He'd can I demonstrate?
Yeah,
sure. He'd do a little there you are. You know,
yeah.
Like he'd finish up, but he's back to the audience and there you are. You know, but only Wallace could do it. Just this and twist around and boom, I'm lost.
If losing the audience was what the old vaudevillians remember best, then to the general public, down there past the footlights, George Wallace meant one thing above all else, his wonderful, eccentric dancing. His sublime movement and timing made him the closest thing Australia had to Chaplin. The moment the music started, you knew something funny was going to happen. And it always did.
Listen, you're mad. He never touched you. Listen, whose side are you on? I believe it was you pushed me.
Oh, yeah, I'm over here and on with the dance.
Oh, see, come somehow, that you're nobody's behind now.
Why are medical costs more crippling than an ingrowing jockette? Because people go to the doctor at the drop of a kidney instead of curing themselves. Next time one of the family slumps to the floor, why fritter away the housekeeping on an ambulance?
Sorry, hold it there.
This is the hard yakka side of modern humour. The endless grind of rehearsals, not just for the performer, but for the directors, writers and production crew behind every show. Today, comedy means television. A monster which lets an audience of millions chew up a year's material in a single night. But somehow there's still space for the development of a new and successful comic invention.
Just get the patient on board with a minimum of fuss, and it's but a hair-raising cross-carpet dash to the casualty kitchen. Thanks, Mr. Simpson.
In Norman Gunston, actor Gary McDonald has created a character both unique and familiar. The little Aussie bleeder has been described as a symbol for the inspired amateurism of Australia as a whole, a naive walking disaster who doesn't even know it.
At normal body temperatures, it takes hours to defrost, you know. But if a patient's really delirious, you won't even have to cook it.
He's like all the great comic figures, that he provokes a varied response.
Yes,
it does. There's tremendous... There is hatred there, isn't there?
From people?
Yeah.
Oh, yes, yes, in the street, yes. I sometimes get it.
What sort of thing?
Oh, I had a woman come up to me the other day. I was in the shopping plaza. And I was signing some autographs, and this woman came up, and this girl had said, I want it for my mother. And this woman came up, you know, and, very heavily made up, very pale, and big rosy cheeks. And she came, she said, and I thought it was the girl's mother, and she said, I've always wanted to meet you, you know. And I said, oh, you know, to tell you how rude you are. She stormed off.
Television also gave us this comic character, and with it, the thankfully short-lived cult of ockerism. It's no surprise to learn that Paul Hogan first came to light in a talent quest. The Hogue's character exudes the kind of crass cockiness, more at home at a prawn night than on stage at the Tivoli.
Good evening, viewers.
With Hogan, it's sometimes difficult to tell where the real-life character ends and the comedian starts.
What's the problem, girl, with the dogs?
We were just discussing the idiosyncrasies of pets in season.
Yeah, I know what you mean. Yeah, Trixie, when, you know, all the hair stand up and the legs and that when she's on.
Is Trixie your dog?
No, Trixie the barmaid down the Royal Oak.
For I see Australia as a great big sort of coal face of boredom, great big heavy boredom. But coal, I believe, under the right conditions, produces diamonds, and we've been very lucky. We've produced one enormous diamond in Barry Humphreys. Captain Cook discovered Australia in 17-something or other. Barry Humphreys rediscovered it in the middle 50s.
Auntie Edna, cool. Careful, Auntie, I think most of my ribs are broken.
Barry Humphreys isn't only Edna Everage, although the housewife superstar is the best of his two most effective creations. The other is Bazza McKenzie, the great Australian suburban dill. Humphreys wrote both the McKenzie movies, but he left the part of playing Bazza himself to Barry Crocker.
Uses a ring of ding blue, hey, Curl? I kicked that bastard Hurt's teeth so far down he straight left to pull his toothbrush up his...
Barrington, if your father was here now and heard you talking like that, he'd turn over in his grave.
Sorry, Auntie Edna, sort of got carried away. Hope you had a bonza time with your mate Madge.
Oh, Madge. Barry, do you remember Madge's little girl, Gaylene? When you were toddlers, she used to play with you.
Is it a bit too personal to ask what your mother is like?
Well, I suppose it is rather personal. I mean, it depends on what you mean.
Anything of Edna there?
Oh, well, you know, Edna is a synthesis of observations. I presume there is a bit of my mother and Edna. I thought there was a lot of my mother and Edna until I met your mother.
Oh, when you're putting them back in, but make sure nothing's...
Sewing them back up.
In the long run, there are no rules in humour, except perhaps one. It doesn't come easily. So, while the rest of us are mowing the lawn or down at the beach, the professional humorists are sweating out their Sundays in rehearsal studios. It makes you realise why working for a laugh is the most common phrase in the world of comedy.
If the patient has a relapse, a couple of days in the home oxygen tent should see a right. However, if you feel you need a second opinion, it's probably best to wheel her into the garage and put an ad in the paper for a used Lamborghini. That way you'll get loads of doctors coming around to give her the once-over. You know?
You must remember this. A kiss is still a kiss. A sigh is just a sigh. The fundamental things apply as time goes by. As time goes by.